Farhan, Ritesh, thank you first of all for letting Film Companion into this very cool office.
Thank you very much.
So this is the Excel conference room.
It is the Excel.
Is this where things, fates get decided?
Insane interviews have happened in this room.
That's what you're using it for.
Basically.
So the two of you have been making movies and projects, other things as well, together for 16 years. And Fukrey is your 18th project out in December. What is the secret of a great creative partnership?
Wow, it's been, is it 18 now?
The 16 years, 18 films.
No, 17 years actually.
17 years?
Yeah, 17 years. And I guess 18 films now. I don't know what exactly the secret of this, the success of this partnership is. I think it's recognizing strength, the strengths in the others. Also, I guess, filling in where the other person has weaknesses. You know, I think that's really how partnerships work. And I think most importantly, I think trust is, the foundation that any kind of partnership can be built on. So it's that. And I would imagine a shared vision, creative vision of the kind of movies that we'd like to do, to produce, to make. I would think that, and great fashion sense.
Indeed.
Matching beards.
No, I think it's a similar...
That's right, you guys do have matching beards.
I think it's a similar sensibility of, I mean, in the kind of work we are in, I think you have to be on the same page in the kind of stories you want to tell. And I think that's what we've been doing from 2001.
How does the creative process work here? I mean, how does a film like the sequel to Fukrey get greenlit? You know, who finds the stories? How do you develop them? And who finally says, yes, let's make it?
I think it's a... So Fukrey is... Mrig has worked with us on Dawn. He was assisting Farhan on Dawn. And he reached out to us when he wrote this film. And we made, so it's a sequel to the first. So I think that's how it happened. But the process, we have a team here which is headed by Kasim. And there are three or four other people who work with him, where people send in their scripts. There's an email ID. And once they read the script, if they think that it's really interesting and they want to bring it to us, they bring it to us. And then there's a discussion which happens, you know, on it, in terms of what do we like in it, what do we not, and then if the writer and the director, or it's only a writer, if he's open to obviously the kind of feedback we have for him, he'll go rework it. So I think it's more like a team, and then after that, once we've liked it, then that's how it's, you know, basically put into the next stage, where we also get other teams involved, like the marketing team. So we just do like a, after we've liked the script, then we bring in another team of people to also just get a narration and hear it.
When Farhan, you spoke about strengths, what are the strengths here? What is it that you specifically do really well, and what is it that you really do well that he doesn't?
I do everything well.
That's right. I'm just brilliant.
Amazing. And the rest I handle.
That's it.
In all honesty, I mean, we've spoken about this in the past as well, because, you know, we've done interviews together where people have asked us about working together, you know, when 10 years happened and then 15 years happened. Ritesh he's very, very organized in putting things together. He enjoys dealing with people. He enjoys making sure that people have a great experience when they're working on an Excel film.
And what is your...
Now it's your turn to praise. Oh, I'm tired.
No, I think,
but
I think about him, everyone's seen, like, I think, you know, you see it in various aspects, everything he does, he's so committed to it. So I think, like, you know, and it's not surprising when you were told that, you know, Farhan's acting, or he sings, or he composes music. So I think every single aspect of this, which is, you know, like the creative, I think it's a great strength to have in your company when you're producing stuff, and you're especially giving a platform to new talent, because most of the films we've made have all been first-time directors.
Is that by design, Ritesh?
I think, you know, it's just that we... it's not by design. I think they come to us with scripts which we, I think, really identify with, we relate to. Their stories which we feel, okay, this is something which we know we want to be a part of. And then having him on this side of it also, it gives them some strength. So, you know, when they're new, I mean, obviously he doesn't start interfering and getting onto the set, I think, but the kind of feedback and the kind, because of his experience on every aspect, you know, of... wherever they get stuck, if they have to come back and ask for something. So I think they trust the advice they get from him on that level. So I think it's great for a production house, which is constantly working with new talent on various aspects, whether it's even we work with new musicians, we've had, you know, various other technicians who have come in. So it's always good to have somebody like that on board, you know.
Farhan, you haven't directed a film since Dawn 2, which was 6 years ago.
Yes, so
Ritesh, do you ever say to him that, Farhan, just give the acting a break and like come back and make something for XL?
No, I mean, you know, I think it's you can't force somebody to do something. I think it comes to him. So I think it's a particular time and phase. I think if there is a story which he really wants to say
you
himself.
You try and seduce him with stories.
No, I mean, no. I think it's he decides. I think like right, he goes through a phase where he feels that right now I'm excited to act and he does that. But I think he has been thinking about directing and thinking that I'll do it. But I think...
Are you?
Yes.
Can you tell us anything?
Yes, that I'm thinking very, very seriously about.
I'm thinking a lot.
No, I do miss it. You know, it's been now like about over the last maybe like year and a half to 2 years is where I've been slowly but surely kind of like thinking about it more and more and more. And like when I'm watching, when I'm on set, and I mean, again, it's not about interfering with what the director's doing. I've also worked very closely with your production recently. You know, so it's not about that, but it's really like feeling like, man, I want to like get back to doing that and putting it all together. That feeling was kind of arising for a while. And I do feel now that there's a nice opportunity where, you know, like there's nothing really committed to having to start. So we've been discussing this a lot because there are certain stories that I wanted to make. So we've been speaking about it and just getting some kind of feedback from him, you know, from even people like my dad, for example, Zoya, about what film really is the one to like kind of really, you know, like sink my teeth into. So that's happening. So hopefully, yeah, I'll let you know soon.
You are going to get back to it.
Yes, it's absolutely.
That's exciting news. That's wonderful. Great.
Only on Film Company.
Ritesh, I was reading an interview you did, and you were talking about what makes this company different. And you said one of the things is we really understand relationships. And you said that you would never pitch to a director or a technician or an actor a project the two of you weren't completely convinced about. So is that true, I wondered, of the films that didn't really pan out? Let's say a Bangistan or a Bar Bar Dekho. Were the two of you 100% convinced of these movies?
Yeah, I think I was. I mean, there was a certain quirky comedy element, if you just take the two films that you're talking about. That was new. It was slightly risque because it spoke about blind faith, you know, and it spoke about humanity above religion. So there were certain messages. At times it happens that things that, you know, like you really, that work for you on paper, maybe don't translate as well when they're put onto screen. That does happen. And I think that possibly is an example of that. But when you read the script, you're constantly laughing through the script. You're engaged through the script. Those two characters, again, they're very, very interesting characters. And there was a certain quirky element, you know, like a call center in the caves of Afghanistan or whatever that place was called, you know. And so there was a lot of quirkiness. Somehow, I mean, I don't know, unfortunately, it didn't translate the way it did. And similarly with Bar Bar Dekho, there's a certain kind of a science fiction, time travel, you know, element in a love story, which seemed new to us. You know, and again, it spoke about how the now is so much more important than constantly planning for the future, which is what most people do. Very few people live enjoying a relationship right now. You know, you're always worried about 2 years from now and 5 years from now. So those messages, you know, like really did work with us, you know, and we thought that it would make for engaging viewing. But it didn't pan out that way. But I mean, in terms of did we feel that these films are 100% the films that we wanted to make? Yeah, absolutely.
You know, Zoya's been such a critical part of XL. And her new film, Gully Boys, is now, she's producing it under her own banner, Tiger Baby, co-produced by XL or co-produced by you?
No, by XL.
XL. Okay, so does that change the working equation in any way or is it just more of the same?
It's absolutely the same. I just think that it's right now her wanting to have a stake in her films and, you know, build her own company. But I think it works. It's being produced under XL. It's the same thing. It's just on paper, it's different. But it's completely the same. The process of greenlighting it, right? And even with Zoya, like, I don't think any of the filmmakers, like, even if he's directing a film, it's the same team which goes back. And I think as a director, writer, you have to be open. If you're stubborn, you're never going to be able to move on. So even Zoya, you'll give her feedback and she'll look at you and she'll say, okay, I understand what you're saying, but this is my reason of going with this. And then you'll be convinced. Or she'll say, listen, this is really good. You know, because all of them are extremely greedy. They want the best thing. So she'll say, yeah, this is really good. Maybe I can bring this in. So I think that every filmmaker should be open to. And I think that's the same process we follow with anybody.
And that's a great name, no? Tiger Baby.
Yeah.
Love it. Of course, XL has also become very much associated with the place for the coming of age, the friendship movies. Is that something you two just naturally gravitated towards, or how did this happen?
I think it happens both ways, you know. I mean, I think there possibly is a certain, you know, like I grew up watching, I mean, all our movies were multi-starers and they were all about being buddies and being friends. They'd have misunderstandings and come back together at the end. So that was the Hindi film side of it. And on the English film side, like I grew up watching like the John Hughes films, you know, The Coming of the Breakfast Club, Ferris Bueller's Day Off. And all those movies, I mean, they were so, I mean, they're young films.
The high school ones.
Yeah, like, you know, those kind of movies. So every time I feel like I hear a script like that, to me, I mean, eventually I may say no, because by the time the script ends, you're just like, what's going on? You know, but I always feel like there's a part of me that's very drawn to that kind of movie. So one is, I think that there is a natural affinity, I think, towards that film, that kind of film. And also because I think of films like Dil Chahta Hai, like Rock On, like Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, I think even writers from the outside, when they think of, oh my, I've got a buddy film.
Come
you
here.
Know, yeah. Maybe let's go to XL, you know, because maybe they like making movies like this. So I think it works both ways.
Yeah. Because even Fukrey is a buddy film.
Absolutely. You know, absolutely.
The friendship is the glue more than the romances or anything else, you know. The other thing that XL gets associated with, like Adharma, is the sort of the high class, the affluence, the look of a film. What is your response to that? I know I've had discussions with Zoya on this and she gets so mad. She's like, one film I made about rich people. But what is your response?
The thing is that if you think about, I mean, we are getting into like discussions, you know, on a larger level. Like one is, regardless of whether the film is about rich people or poor people, the fact is that is the story engaging you or not? You know, I remember very clearly, I had gone to Delhi many years ago after Dil Chahta Hai released, and somebody got up and asked me, you know, aap to matlab sheher ke logon ke bare mein film banate ho, ameer logon ke bare mein film banate ho, that is not India, you know, that kind of question. I'm like, but why is it not India? I mean, India is different for different people, you know. So why are we so like allergic to rich people having problems? It's not that they don't have problems. In fact, you should be happy when you see rich people, if you see really rich people having problems, that even their lives are more or less the same as yours. So I felt that Zoya got an unnecessary amount of flack
with
Dil Dhadakne Do, you know, because they were like, "Arey, helicopter nahi khareed sakta ya plane nahi khareed sakta." The fact is that people have different problems at different levels, and her film was about talking about patriarchy in society, and that society exists as much in really affluent and rich people as it does in other films and other strata of society that we've seen. But given that, you know, I feel that one is, XL has made films, so be it Talash, be it Fukrey, be it Honeymoon Travels Private Limited. Rock On is not about rich people. You know, there's one character who's rich, the rest are not. Luck by Chance is not about rich people. And there are films like that. The thing is that you are remembered for the movies that people choose to remember you for. You know, so it's also selective memory on part of people who are asking you this question. So there's some introspection is required on their end, I feel as well. And secondly, I think, again, what's truly important is the film working for you as a film? I don't think we need to get into why is it about rich people, or why is it not about a village, or why is it about a city. I don't think that's the important thing.
Sure.
The thing is that, is the conflict in the film, is the drama in the film engaging you or not?
Farhan, you talked about Dil Chahta Hai, which for me was, and not just for me, for most people, was a real game changer. It sort of changed the way we looked at Hindi cinema. It changed the textures and the way people talked and looked and, you know, all the rest of it. Do you two wonder what was the magic that, how do the stars align when you first started out, and how do you sort of get lightning in the bottle again?
You know, I don't know. I mean, I don't think there's any kind of recipe to figure out how things are going to work the way they're going to work. Any film that you make, I mean, you can, of course, everyone wants their film to be successful. If I take a film like that's been produced by Bye Vidhu, you know, when you all made Three Idiots, for example, I mean, there must have been a feeling that, okay, the film is working really well. Everyone's saying really good things about the film. The script was enjoyable. Raju's, you know, done some good work before this, and let's make this, put this film together. I don't know if you'd expect the kind of cult status that the film can take on. Similarly with Munna Bhai. You know, like there's a certain enjoyment, and when people read the script, actors that we went to met them, they all enjoyed the script. There was something fresh, something new. But nobody can imagine what the film will become for people. That you can't imagine. You know, so there's it happens completely miraculously. You know, and it happens, I mean, wonderfully for the people when it does happen. But there is no design to it. There is no hope for it.
Did you ever imagine? I mean, I've read sort of pieces on the three characters and what it means. And I, you know, I mean, just really, and sort of meanings in the silences, in the he turned, but there's a shot of this, you know. Did you ever, when the two of you were making this, I mean, you've known each other since you were in school, you set out these young kids to make this film. Did you ever think it would become this?
I mean, you know, the thing is, actually, I'll tell you a very strange story on that film. When Farhan narrated it to me, now the for me, when I'm looking at it on paper, like, you know, and you identify with all these three characters. So, you know, at some point in your life, you've been through what Sid is going through. You've been through what Akash is going through. Through Sami is going through. All the characters you've been through at some point, and you've also
been through what Sid has been through.
Yeah, of course. Why not? So I'm saying you have.
Good to know.
Yeah, of course.
I've said this before also. But you've been through all the three characters and you identify. So for me, I said, God, this film will identify with everybody. Because if I can feel there'll be somebody in every part of this country to say that, okay, I understand this. So I was feeling that when we finished the film, okay, so I had no idea, like, you know, completely coming from a non-film background in Farhan. And I mean, though Farhan had been a part of film, but we had never produced a film together. So we started showing the film to all the distributors and who were used to seeing. So they had just released Lagan, and Amir said, you know, all my distributors are really good, show them. And one by one, they saw the film and they started leaving the film. They said, ye kya banani aap log ne? This film is not going to work. So I had to get Anil Thadani in to release the movie for us in three territories at that point. So actually, most of the film fraternity, like the business guys, who saw the movie actually left the film after paying us for it. And they said, we want our money back, but this movie is never going to work.
So truly nobody knows anything.
Yeah. No, you don't. I mean, I remember without taking names, you know, at that time, there were many players buying music. You know, now it's just one or two. But there were many. And I remember this one gentleman who came in, who was the head of that music label. And he came in and he was a friend of Dad's, of course. And Dad said, you know, ab jaake sun lo, dekh lo, gaane waane, sab shoot ho chuke hain. So he came and he watched it. And the song started listening and he got onto his phone, started talking, haan ji, main aata hu, and went on. I was like, I don't want this guy to even buy the music, you know. And I mean, it was like that kind of feeling. And it's crazy. I mean, like, I feel like, I think what's really, really stayed, I mean, of course, characters stay, but it's what the characters do and say, you know, I think that really remains with people. And I feel dialogue plays a very, very crucial role in that for a long memory, a long legs. You know, I remember one very, like, distinct moment. We were driving back from famous Mahalakshmi. We were shooting the Koi Kahe Kehta Rahe song. And we were driving back, and at that time, there was me, I can't remember, there was one other person in the car, and Preeti was also there, because she was also staying in Bandra. We were all driving back together. And when we were driving back, suddenly she, like, looked at me and she said, you know, Farhan, this is going to be a cult movie. She's the only person who's ever said that to me before the film was made. So I was like, really? She's like, it's going to be a cult film. So I said, wonderful, yeah, how nice, great. Yeah, so she was the only person who said
that. How wonderful. Yeah. You know, my memory of the film is watching it at Famous, I think, is where you had called the industry, was it? Oh.
Yeah.
It was at Famous, yeah, right? Yeah. And it was like, it got over at some very, like, one or two, you know, the usual trials.
Yeah.
And Vinod said it was so good. And I was like, it was so good. And I said, you should call his mom. Because if my son made a movie that was as good as this, I would want somebody to wake me up and tell me. And I think he did.
He did
call her in the middle of the night and said, it's wonderful. So congratulations. And you know, just keep knocking them out.
Shall keep trying.
Please. And wait, I forgot. What is his most annoying trait, and what is his most annoying trait?
This has become like a annoying trait.
Yeah. What's like the one thing you would change about Farhan if you could?
He's always on time. So I would like to change that.
And you're not? Are you?
I'm 15 minutes late. And for him, even that's a big deal. So.
Well, he said he has OCD, so he's very...
So that's very annoying, because he's always on time. That's the problem. You know?
Well, you can. That's a good thing.
For things that matter. No, otherwise, what's up?
And his?
The one thing that I'd like to change.
Morning meetings.
Yeah. No, you know, I think, I feel with certain things, I feel he finds it like a little difficult. He wants to constantly be the one in charge of organizing things, doing things. And I feel at times it's nice to kind of like let go and other people do some stuff as well. So maybe that once in a while.
So these are all backhanded compliments, basically.
No, these are not. These are not backhanded. Akalmand ko ishara hi kafi.
If you like this video, subscribe to Film Companion. We will bring you all that's new and exciting in the movies.